and bring your awareness to your posture. You can mentally walk down your spine, vertebrae by vertebrae, imagining everything comes into perfect alignment, that all the surrounding muscles and tissues release and relax. Pulling your focus all the way down to your seat. Feel very grounded and connected to the earth. Allow your legs to relax into place. Give them any extra support they need with cushions or change of posture. Nothing should feel like it's tight or holding. And think, in order to connect with and expand inner peace and spaciousness, in order to send out the conditions for outer peace and outer spaciousness, I'm going to meditate today. And with that motivation, shift your focus to the breath. And try to bring an objective attitude towards your own thoughts as you watch the breath. The thoughts don't have to be true or false, interesting or boring, with or without words. It doesn't really matter what the content of the thoughts is right now. Just allow the natural flow of them without giving particular interest or significance to any. They aren't the object of focus. They are like clouds passing by. Try to remain anchored to the breath. Every breath is a chance for recovery, for integration, to digest. Every breath a chance to release yourself from the busyness or the heaviness. So just keep choosing the breath. And as your mind becomes accustomed to watching thoughts without following them, allow the focus of the breath to release and just be with the spacious clarity of the mind. Be in that vast sky-like nature, reflective and clear. Marry your attention to it. And then finish by thinking, may whatever peace and clarity I've connected with and found, may it benefit all those around me. And relax your attention. Okay, so hi everybody. Today I thought we'd talk a little bit about the relationship between equanimity and love. Because if we're with the same people and interacting with the same people all the time, sometimes we can miss out on the connections that are right in front of us and start to feel disconnected from the people right in front of us because we've started to take them for granted. We can also be missing the people that we used to see often, and now because of the current situation, we're not seeing them as often, or we're not being able to see them in person and have that, you know, lived connection of, you know, having a hug, of sharing a meal, and that kind of thing that we're used to doing. And so if we look at the sort of the connection between equanimity and love, it can open back up the possibilities of feeling nourished and enriched by every interaction. And I think that equanimity in Buddhism is something very easily misunderstood because it's deceptively simple. There is three different places this word comes up, and it has three different meanings, but we often hear it in just one of those places and then mix them all together as if it's all always that. So in Buddhism, we might talk about a feeling of equanimity, just meaning neutrality, right? Just feeling neutral, a mental factor. We might talk about being equanimous in meditation, which is not applying antidotes to the difficulties in our meditation when they're not necessary, resting in equanimity or applied equanimity. So those two types of equanimity have the connotation of, you know, balance, neutrality, you know, not necessarily attached, not necessarily angry, just kind of a, you know, a nice neutral way of being. And that's not the kind of equanimity we talk about as the foundation for love. That's where we get into this realm of immeasurable equanimity, which is basically the foundation of everything higher, like compassion and love. And it means that you have unbiased goodwill, which doesn't mean that suddenly everyone becomes like beige or gray or bland. It doesn't mean that all of your relationships are suddenly identical. It doesn't mean that you have the same way of being with every single person. Not that at all. It means you understand regular worldly relationships. You understand the karmic connection you have with people is different. You understand people's way of communicating is different. And all of that is surface, because what is the same is that your heart is equally open, regardless. So instead of making everybody bland and beige and pretending that all of your relationships are the same, that's not at all the type of equanimity we're talking about. But it's easy to misunderstand, because in other places in Buddhism, we talk about the same word and it has a different connotation. So we're saying kind of like, if everyone is still colors, well, some people are red and some people are blue, but I like red and I like blue, but it doesn't mean that they're the same color, you know? And so what we're trying to do is to kind of even out the way our heart decides where I can be open or not. Because in those relationships where the heart is just naturally open, we have a lot of peace, right? We're really relaxed with the people we love, with the people we know, they accept us, we accept them. There's just kind of a baseline relaxation that comes with the open heart of love. And then we deprive ourselves of that with people that we don't love. Yeah, as soon as we're with someone we don't particularly love or have affection for, the heart shuts down. Yeah, there's kind of like a closed heart and even a physiological experience of tension that can happen. And the illusion is that closing up shop, closing up the heart, is some sort of protection from people that are harmful or people that are not well motivated or people that are going to criticize us or don't like us or whatever the case may be. The illusion is closing the heart is protection. And so that's the illusion that we want to confront in this particular topic. We want to really argue with that a little bit and see that it's not logic-based. And it also means that we miss out on a level of joy in interaction that we don't need to miss out on. That we can be with a very difficult person that we don't have easy rapport with, who the conversation is not flowing, where there is not a lot in common, where, you know, they're not your favorite person to be around, and yet you can still have unbiased goodwill. You can still think, may you be well, may you be happy, and having a heart-open sending experience, which gives you great peace, great relaxation, and is of course really nice for them as well. And makes it far more likely that they'll become easier to live with as well, easier to deal with. You know, if someone is meeting you with love, it brings out the best in you. That's just, you know, basic common sense, but we forget. So it's easy enough to just talk about it, isn't it? And you think, yeah, that's logical, but I can't just force it. You know, if I'm with someone who I don't have a connection with and who feels like a threat, whether real or imagined, I'm going to shut down. It's only natural. It's only human. So just knowing that equanimity is a nice way to be is not enough to like force open the heart, nor should we. Right? So what you want to do is when you're not with someone who is confronting you, to just kind of step back from our labels a little bit and ask ourselves, do all the ways we label people really function well? And are they logical? So this is like an examination of projection, isn't it? You're asking, all right, let's just categorize everyone into three: friend, enemy, stranger. Let's just categorize everyone into those three categories, because we do anyway, even if we don't name it. Even if we pretend we don't have any enemies, there are people that we dislike. There are people that annoy us, that trigger irritation, that we have a little cringe from. And we would not call them enemies, or, you know, it's not our way of speaking. And yet in our mind, that aversion says threat. Keep them away. Keep them at some distance. Keep my time with them limited and small. Get them away. With friends, we want them close. We have attachment towards our friends, not just love, right? We have love that wants them to be happy, but we also have a huge amount of attachment that wants them to make us happy and kind of thinks it's their job too. Yeah. So we're not saying that the people you love, you don't love them. You do love them, but you also have a lot of attachment to them, and that is part of the problem. And then with strangers, these are people that, you know, either you don't know at all, or they're like friendly acquaintances, you know, or just people that you see a lot, but you haven't really branded. And these strangers, as soon as you kind of put them in that category, then you have indifference. Yeah. So with enemies, you have aversion. With friends, you have attachment. With strangers, you have indifference. And all three of those are considered negative states of mind. You can still have those same labels without those negative states of mind. Yeah, you can sort of frame people as, look, this person has qualities and behaviors that are hard for me to work with and are damaging for society, and I can label that with some objectivity, but that has nothing to do with how open my heart is towards them. This other person, I can have, you know, no idea about them or their life. I can, you know, they're a complete stranger to me. They don't hurt me. They don't help me. They don't do anything for me, but I can still have an open heart towards them. And this person that I love might behave in ways that are not my preference. And that does not dictate how much love they get, whether they're behaving the way I want them to or not. Giving and taking my affection shouldn't be like a punishment or a reward. It's a bit superficial, right? So that's the first level, is just kind of like sitting with that possibility. And then you go even deeper and you ask yourself, where do these labels come from anyway? How self-referent they are. And this is all really easy logic, but we don't make our mind work through these processes very often. And so we just take our relationships on face value and let them just operate. They always have been. So what you do is you ask yourself, when I like someone and I want them near me, why? And just sit with, why do I want them near me? You know, and it's like you've got a clipboard and you're a scientist and you're like, I like them near me because we have the same sense of humor. We have the same core values. We like the same things, or the things that are different, I find interesting and intriguing and entertaining. Or I would like to live up to something I see in them, or whatever, you know. So you're making your list, and some of the list is, you know, profound and spiritual and enriching and nourishing, and some of it's really superficial and basic and, you know, just getting what you want. You know, it's a combo, right? Your list of why I like them. But then you kind of take that and you think, all right, so that's my criteria for love. And it's not really a complete list of logic. Some of it's just nonsense and some of it's just preferences, but I use that as my reason for why my heart opens. That's my reason. Is that a valid reason for having a heart open? you know? And is it the case that this person who I label as friend is inherently friend from their own side, or inherently likable in and of themselves? And you got to step away, you know, you hold, like, take an example of like your best friend or your partner or something like that. And you kind of sit with that and you think, is there anyone who does not like them? Sure, they tell you about them all the time, right? There are lots of people who dislike your closest friend, who you think is just beautiful and glorious and nothing but wonderful. There are people that really dislike them. And you always think, well, look, if they only knew them, if they only knew them, they would love them the way I love them, right? If they only knew them like I know them. And that's the very point. If they knew them the way you knew them, they would love them. Meaning, if they had the same projections as you, right? Or if they saw the same tiny keyhole of their qualities and zeroed in on them as the most significant, then that would come back to them and they would have the same response, right? And this is what we're doing with all of our relationships, is people have this huge landscape of qualities, you know, good and bad, difficult and skillful. They have this huge landscape. And then we're looking through this tiny keyhole and seeing this tiny amount, labeling that as the complete picture, and then deciding that our projections about that are completely true and it feeds back on itself. You know, it's classic kind of projection, isn't it? But if you can kind of do that with the label itself, rather than all of the people one by one acknowledging your projections, stand back and do the labels. So you can pick one friend as your example to do this with, but think of them as representing all friends, all people in that category of, I want you close. A lot of why we want people close is we think they benefit us. Yeah. A lot of why we want people close is there's a feeling of stability and permanence. Yeah. A lot of why we want people close is what it says about me that they like me. And all of those pieces are worth challenging. Not so that you lose your love, but so that you lose your attachment. Because attachment in Buddhism is exaggerating the good qualities, right? It's seeing the good qualities, and then it's exaggerating either how much they are, how stable they are, or their significance. It's thinking that their qualities have like self-existent significance, and they don't, right? And so, you know, what you start with is, all right, are they actually beneficial? Yeah, are they actually beneficial, my friend? Of course they are, in some ways, in some contexts, but let's look at the ways they are not beneficial. Because I'm trying to get rid of attachment, right? Not because I'm trying to look down on them. Because I'm trying to free up my heart so it's love that is present, clean and clear and flowing. Yeah. And so you think, all right, actually, because of this relationship, sometimes I do negative things that I wouldn't otherwise do. Sometimes they are a bad influence on me. Sometimes I talk about things in a way that I feel ashamed of later, for example. You know, you might gossip about things or people. You might get critical in ways that aren't really like you, but because of their influence brings that out of you, right? Things like that. You could think about the fact that sometimes because of your preference for this person, you are unkind to someone else. Yeah, you ice them out or, you know, get cliquish, and all of those horrible things we see with adolescents are still present within us in more sophisticated and subtle forms, but they're still there and it's still bad because it's still harmful. Yeah. And so you're just taking a step back and just kind of, all right, it's actually not beneficial, this friendship in and of itself, right? There is benefit, but not in and of itself. Also, it's not permanent and stable, even if we've been friends for 20 years. Because one whole day with them, if I was to spend one whole day with my favorite person, would they feel close the whole day? Would they feel identically close the whole day? Or would there be chapters? Right? Some moments you know, say you're having a holiday together. One, you know, in the morning, one of you is a morning person, one of you isn't. There's a little bit of a jangle, right? And then you make your plans for the day. Sometimes they're in sync, sometimes they're not.
you go into the first activity of the day. That activity is something one of you has more energy for than the other. There's a little edge of tension. Then maybe eventually you have to talk about your tension, and it relaxes and releases, and now you feel really close, even closer than before, until you get distracted, and then you're kind of vague and each doing your own thing, and it's like you're strangers, right? So you could go through one whole day with this person you love, but feel friend, enemy, stranger just cycling through the whole day, couldn't you? Yeah, so that illusion of stability, illusion of permanence, is an illusion we need to name and acknowledge. Because part of why we cling and grasp is an assumption of stability. And together with that is the happiness I have with them, I can't have unless they are there, which leads to grief if they leave or die. Yeah, that this is a specific type of happiness that only works with them. They are giving it to me from their side, nothing to do with my acceptance of it, and I need them for this experience. It's a huge exaggeration, isn't it? And yet when we believe it, it becomes true. And the loss of it becomes devastating. Yeah. So you do this with friends, and you know, you look at, all right, it's not beneficial from its own side. It's not permanent as I thought it was. A lot of this is my own projections, because if they were innately likable, everyone would like them, right? And then you shift to a stranger and you do the same process, right? You think, are they innately not beneficial because they're a stranger and they do nothing for me? You think, oh, of course, everything I need and use in my everyday life comes from strangers. Yeah, my food, my clothing, my transportation, the roads, the house, you know, I mean, everything I'm using all the time is directly from the work of strangers. And, you know, in those times I've been alone on the road somewhere and the car breaks down, it's strangers that have come and helped me out of a difficult situation, or it's strangers that have shown me a new way of looking at things, blah, blah, blah. You're trying to remember times when strangers have been very beneficial to you. Because that makes your heart relax and open back up once you've branded someone this way. Yeah, you know how wonderful it is when you're in that heart open space in a crowd and you feel like you're part of the human community, and there's this flow and there's this relaxation. You know, say it's a Saturday and you don't have to work, and you know, you're walking down the boulevard in Tel Aviv along the sea, maybe it'll open soon. You know, so you're walking along the boulevard and there's all those people and everyone is in a similar holiday mood, and you just feel that beautiful flow of humanity and connection. And you sit on a bench and someone else is sitting on the bench a little ways away, and you just naturally start to talk to each other. You know, I mean, Israelis are great at this, right? Of connecting with strangers. It's one of the most beautiful things. You know, I can be at the grocery store and just being like, is that milk or yogurt? I'm not sure. I have to look at my phone, do the thing. Or I could just ask the person next to me and they will help me. And they're not going to be like, oh my God, why is this weird looking stranger talking to me? 99% of the time they're like, oh, I would like to explain things to you. Also, let's chat. It's so beautiful, right? But when your heart is closed, you could be in that same crowd and you have those days where you keep bumping into people accidentally. You know, when you're out of sync with the human flow. And so, you know, you're sort of like, oh, should I be on this side of the path or this side of the path? You go around a corner and kind of bump someone, and you're just kind of out of sync. Yeah. And the people around you in the lines at the grocery store or wherever you are, they feel like aliens that you're suspicious of and you want them to hurry up and get out of your way. Yeah, that feeling starts. Like, just hurry up and finish your thing. I need to do my thing. Come on, come on. And there's that like impatience that happens. So what we're looking at is that the way you're looking at it is opening or closing your heart, and how relaxed and happy you are is directly related to how opened or closed your heart is. Plus, you're nicer to society when you have an open heart. You're, you know, and that creates a ripple effect. You know, all of the times that that's happened to you, where a stranger has been kind to you, then your heart that was a little bit closed that day opened, and then you were nice to someone and it had that beautiful domino effect, right? So it's things we already know about life, but it's bringing that knowledge back to the surface, back to the forefront of our minds, so that we don't lose it. And then you think about your enemy, you know, and you might not have a big enemy in your life, or maybe you have a difficult trauma from, you know, 30 years ago, but you don't see them anymore. You don't have like big, you know, enemies hunting you or something in the forest, but there are people that regularly annoy you, right? There are people that regularly annoy you that you wish weren't in your life, or you wish they would change, probably, right? If we're honest, or at least there have been at some point in the past. And so we bring them into our frame and we ask the same questions. Is it true that they are not beneficial? Is it true that that is the state of affairs? And then you sit back and you realize probably all of the traits and strengths and resiliencies we have were born from difficulty. And most of those difficulties involve difficult people. They gave us some of the greatest gifts. They might have been actually even more beneficial than our closest friend. And we don't want to give them credit for that because they didn't intend to help. You know, they weren't thinking, how can I benefit you? No, they were thinking, how can I tear you down? Or maybe they just carelessly are like that. Nevertheless, they were of benefit. And if you can sit with that long enough to touch gratitude, your heart can open in response to them as well. Even if you still keep them at some distance, even if still having them in your life is not a safe or healthy thing, psychologically, you're not shutting down every time their face comes into your mind's eye, or every time they walk into the room, you're not closing down. We give people we dislike so much power that we could be walking around and see across the street someone who looks like them, and we think it's them, and we have the same response as if it were actually them. Our heart shuts down, we get tense and annoyed, and then we look again and realize, oh, it's not even them. Yeah, it's someone that looks like them. But our response was the same, which shows us it's just all our mind stealing our own peace. Yeah, so the way to kind of like work your way into an open heart with that is to think of all of the ways that relationship has led to a resiliency in you that you value, a knowledge of humanity you didn't have before, a way of checking in with your own lack of conditional love, important to know that, all the ways that you've learned from that relationship. If you think about it long enough, it can touch a gratitude that your ego doesn't like, right? But let it touch a gratitude. And when you have gratitude, the heart opens back up. And then you think similarly about the fact that if they were inherently unlikable, no one would like them. And of course, there are people in their life for whom they are very important, who they are the one that they light up when they see, if only to their mother, right? So if they were inherently unlikable, everyone would have the same response. The fact that people don't all have the same response shows your own projection. Yeah. It's classic, it's easy, right? It's common sense, but remind yourself to give yourself back your joy, yeah? To give yourself back your relaxation. And when you have a calm mind, it's easier to deal with difficult people also. So then if you need to actually act physically or verbally, you're in the best position to do so. So this is the equanimity sort of analysis that you do, is you choose someone in your life who triggers attachment, who triggers indifference, who triggers aversion, and you use them as your examples for all sentient beings, everything with a mind. And you just unpack it from those angles. So you acknowledge your own projections, you look at the lack of permanence. Yeah, you look at the fact that there is a way of finding benefit in every interaction. Yeah, and you know, you kind of relax into, may all sentient beings have happiness and the causes of happiness. May they be free of suffering and the causes of suffering. Genuinely from my heart, I wish that. And then they can behave any old way and it doesn't steal your peace because you haven't robbed yourself of it. So equanimity is the basis for loving kindness and compassion, because without it, you start using your love and your compassion as a reward for those you love and a punishment for those you don't love by withdrawing it. Yeah, you punish the people that aren't doing what you want by withdrawing your affection and closing down your heart, not realizing how much that hurts you to do so. So it's a basic teaching, you know, it's a straightforward teaching, but it can be very useful. So questions about that, thoughts? I don't know, is it in alignment with how you think about the world? It's, you know, or is there some parts where you really don't agree?
When you speak about projection, the question that pops in my head is if you think that everything that we see are projections, or actually when we discover the way everybody is lovable, it's not a projection anymore. So we are seeing them.
It's like a gradual process of making our projections more and more expansive, more and more intelligent, you know, sort of like fine-tuning our projections so they're closer to relative truth, and then eventually not having projections at all, and, you know, sort of opening out into this, in, you know, interdependence that we talk about in Buddhism, or the fact that that nothing exists from its own side by way of its own character. And the natural conclusion of that is therefore compassion makes sense, doesn't even need to be conjured up, it just is there, unfabricated. We call it non-referential compassion. And so we work our way into non-referential compassion that is just expansively, may you be free of your suffering, without any kind of bias, without any kind of belief in labels. But we can't force that space. And so we gradually just kind of increase our intelligence about our projections before we try and get rid of projections altogether. It's like, you know, it's kind of like upgrading them, expanding them. It's a bit like as soon as you know someone's history of why they have a difficult behavior, everyone relaxes about their difficult behavior and they don't have to change. People are just forgiving and accepting once they get the backstory. We had a monk in our monastery who it was really socially inept and really rude and used to just be abrupt and blunt, and we just couldn't figure out why he wouldn't smooth out the edges. And then we found out that he was on the autism spectrum, and then we all forgave him and we're like, oh, sure, yeah, fine, just be as you are, live your life, you know? But it was like, before knowing that, we were all hitting our heads against the wall of, why is he like this? Why is he doing this? Just basic politeness, just basic human kindness. Why, you know? And we were so frustrated, and then we realized the reason, and then we all relaxed. And he's not any different, you know, 15 years later. He's still basically the same kind of rude, blunt guy, and we all find it sort of endearing now. You know, we think it's kind of adorable. And, you know, he's just part of our community. And so it is interesting the way we relax once we know the backstory. But if we could relax knowing, if we knew the backstory, we would relax. Then we don't have to find out all the details every single person, every single time. We can just jump to that conclusion. If I knew the story, I would give them a break. You know, if I knew the story.
My question was more for the other side of things. Learning is very understandable for us because that's what we do as therapists in a way. But my question was, when you see this adorable person that you came to love and understand, do you call that a projection too, or projections are just for the part where you how can I say, leave the other person outside you, or mark him as somebody that you should keep a distance from him? I mean, projections, is everything a projection, or are we using this term just for the difficult cases?
Yeah, everything is a projection. Absolutely.
Everything is a projection. Yeah. So there is not, if my question with that is, if everything is a projection, so there is no one there to love. There is no.
That's going too far, right? because this is, and this is getting into the deep Buddhism, right? You're getting into the stuff that we go the most deeply with and have the most arguments about. So it's not like a quick conversation, but it is an interesting conversation, which is basically everything has two aspects. It has a relative truth and an ultimate truth, right? So if we take something simple that we're not going to argue about, we would say, you know, relatively, this is a cup, right? Relative truth says this is a cup. Why? Because we project cup on the parts, right? We project, we're projecting cup. This is not a cup from its own side. Otherwise, we would know it was a cup before we were introduced, you know, as children, right? Like when you're a very tiny child and you're picking something up, it could just as easily be a hat, right? It could be a hat. It could be, I don't know, something to hit your brother with. I don't know. It could be anything. So if it was self-existent, self-evident, we would not need to be introduced, which shows that it's a projection. But its relative truth is that it performs the function of holding liquid, and there is no problem with that. Yeah, it performs the function of our projection, which means our projection is in alignment with relative truth. Its ultimate truth is that it is completely empty of being a cup from its own side because it's dependent. Not because it's nothing, not because there's nothing there or no one there. It's able to be a cup because of its parts and the labeling process and the causes and conditions and. So it's like emptiness isn't nothingness. Emptiness is a lack of base reality. But there is still conventional truth, right? So you can say conventionally, this person's behavior is harmful and this person's behavior is helpful. You can say conventionally that's true and that our conventional projections are in alignment with worldly convention. You know, we can do that. And then we take a step back and say, and there is nothing that is inherently good or bad in and of itself. It's all dependent on context, which is work that you guys do anyway, right? So, you know, you could say, yeah, objectively, this horrible trauma that happened was bad and harmful, and because of the process of therapy or the process of meditation or whatever, I've come to reframe it into the very thing that broke open my heart and opened me into the spiritual path and led me to my vocation or whatever it is, right? These sort of things happen all the time through reframing. But the very fact that we can reframe a situation shows that it's not self-existent from its own side. Otherwise, we couldn't reframe it. So it's this delicate razor's edge that we're trying to hit in Buddhism, which is that cause and effect exist, right? And nothing exists in and of itself from its own side. But, you know, there is still good and bad, just not inherently. So if you tip too far one way or the other, you're going into the extremes. So the middle way that we talk about in Buddhism is this middle way that doesn't fall into nihilism, thinking there's nothing and no one, or eternalism that thinks it's in and of itself, it has a core, there's some sort of, you know, hub to pivot from. Yeah, both of those are exaggerations. So there is a person, the person is merely labeled on the collection of parts. That's the conventionally existent person, that which is merely labeled on the collection of parts or the conditions or the history or whatever, there's a label there. But if you're to point to any one piece, it isn't the person, is it? Yeah, and every piece that you point to has its own pieces or has its own history or has its own context. So, you know, so when we're thinking about projection, what's the biggest projection or the most problematic projection is the projection of self-existent I and me, which is why we have other, enemy, friend, stranger. We wouldn't have other, friend, enemy, stranger if we didn't have this projection of self-existent I. So who am I? Well, I'm empty of inherent existence, but still, if you pinch me, I'm going to say, ouch. You know, the two aren't contradictory. Yeah. So it's delicate, isn't it? This philosophical point. So the ultimate truth of something and the relative truth of something live in the same place at the same time, which is why there's no such thing as, I don't know, something that is empty without a referent. Yeah. So you can only say the emptiness of a cup if there's a cup there. There's only the emptiness of a person if there's a person there. emptiness itself is empty, sure, but we're also always talking about a referent, you know, the conventionality of it, the basis. So everything needs a valid basis in order to be labeled in this way. So projections, you know, what we're trying to do is just this process of recognizing everything is a projection, but to live in the world and think everything is a projection will make us unable to function at our level. So His Holiness recommends think 90% of everything is your projection. 90%, even though it's 100, think everything is your, you know, think 90% of everything you label is your own projection. Yeah, because it frees things up. It frees up possibilities. It frees up openness. And the natural conclusion of nothing existing from its own side is that it doesn't make sense to hurt anything because you're hurting yourself. That's why compassion makes perfect sense when you think about emptiness. Yeah. It's like, if you think we're not all one, but we are all interconnected. We're so fundamentally interconnected that we're like one body. So I wouldn't say that the left hand is the right hand. They're not one, but they are connected, right? So I pinch this hand doesn't hurt immediately, but the whole system is slightly diminished, right? Because now the, you know, whatever system needs to be engaged to help cope with pain management. And I've made this hand weaker by hurting this hand, but the directness of it isn't obvious to us. But still there's an acknowledgement that there's a system. So this is the way we're trying to think about other people, is that they're all part of this interconnected system, but that doesn't mean that we're all the same. It's like a giant network, and it becomes blurry where I stop and you begin. But conventionally, we can say, this is my name, this is your name. So definitely, that's the direction equanimity is taking us, for sure. So it is the right conclusion to come to is, wait a minute, what about projections altogether? That is the way where we're supposed to go. So the teaching on equanimity and the teaching on impermanence are, you know, very easy to sit with intellectually. They're hard to practice, but if you sit with them long enough, it leads you to emptiness. Both of them do. Yeah. And that's where we want to go, because that's going to fundamentally cut all the reasons for negative states of mind. It's going to just cut it. Done. But in the meantime, while we're still just, you know, learning and new and just trying to live in this world, knowing we have projections, trying not to believe all our projections and yet having projections, because if we don't project stop onto the stop sign, then there's going to be trouble. You know, if we completely go into the mystical side of it without the necessary foundations, it's a recipe for madness. Yeah, and it's why you get the kind of certain archetypal, you know, glassy-eyed fanatic or, you know, sort of lost waif at various spiritual centers, is they've gone too far too fast into philosophy. They haven't walked the foundations to get to, and it makes them a bit nutty. Yeah. So, you know, so that's why we do these gradual processes of, all right, when I have a reaction, whatever the reaction is, let's look at my own projection. You know, that doesn't need to have any kind of spirituality to it, right? It can be just some good old basic psychology. It could be basic common sense from your grandmother. It doesn't have to be anything owned by anyone, but we all know it's useful to examine our own projections. I think what's different is why. Why do we examine our own projections? Is it just to have more relief, temporary peace, to live in this world with less stress? Sure, that's a good reason. But do we want to actually be a better citizen, a better family member, someone who is of benefit in this world? That's an even better reason. And then an even better reason is, what if we stop being in any kind of harmful element in this world? And right now we do a lot of harm, even though we're nice people who try not to, you know, just by consuming, yeah, just by all of our kind of afflicted needs. You know, we do a lot of harm. And so if we can really get on top of our projections, we're going to stop harming others. And eventually we might even be able to benefit them by engaging their wisdom and helping it wake up. So if you can kind of have the biggest reason for looking at it, then you have temporary stress relief, right? But if you aim just for temporary stress relief, then all the effort you put into that temporary stress relief ends once you have stress relief for that day or that moment. But if you have this big reason, this vast reason of, actually, this is part of the purpose of my life, is to stop believing everything I think, and to help bring that kind of inner peace ability out of other people. That's actually a beautiful purpose. And so motivate when it's going to have all of the side effects, which are more temporary, and that's lovely. But now I'm oriented, and I'm getting momentum, and it's going somewhere. I don't know. What do you think? Yeah, right.
Hi, Emily. I want to ask about difference. If you can say more about it, about the difference between love and attachment. Isn't that when we love someone, we attach to him? We are not monks, so. If you have people you really, really love, so it can be very hard if there is loss or damage or the harm.
Yeah, for us, yeah. I mean, you know, just sitting with the Buddhist idea of attachment, not the psychological idea of attachment. The Buddhist idea of attachment is that you see what is good and then you exaggerate its importance. Or you think that the good exists from its own side. Or you see the good in isolation from the whole story. So the easiest way to see attachment is you know, really think about like adolescent love, right? Adolescent love. So like when two kids have a crush on each other and they're so excited, right? You know, when they're so excited and they just can't help, they just want to be together all the time. They must be together all the time. And it just like everything the other one does is perfect and good. You know, even if they, I don't know, have a big pimple on their face, they think, oh, it's so cute. You know, like they're just like lost in attachment, right? You know, adolescent love. And what happens is that at some point, the spell is broken, and then they hate each other, right? When the spell is broken, basically means that attachment eventually started to get some cracks in it. And rather than seeing the good qualities in isolation, they're starting to see the whole picture of the person, or closer to the whole picture of the person, which was always the case. But attachment only let them see the good. And now that they see the whole picture, they're completely betrayed. Like, how dare you be this way? How dare you? As if there's been a lie. When in fact, they were like that the whole time. It was just attachment didn't let them see it. Yeah, but then there's this rage. So you can usually tell if there was attachment. If when attachment doesn't get what it wants, it's angry. When it's love, when love doesn't get the plans of love, it's more wondering, oh, what's wrong? Are you okay? What's wrong? Yeah. So attachment says, what is wrong with you? And love says, oh, what's wrong? You're suffering, right? And so for us, we go back and forth now that we're adults, and it's nothing to do with monks or nuns or lay people. I have plenty of attachment, you know, I mean, you should see me with my cat when I go home to visit my parents. I'm just like, this cat is the source of all happiness. We will be together infinitely, right? I completely project this cat is giving me happiness. The cat's like, whatever, if you feed me, sure. You know, we all have attachment that exaggerates, but to break the spell means you open up the love even faster. Right. And so if you can acknowledge, okay, in this one relationship that will be my example of all relationships, how does my mind dysfunction when attachment is present? And how do I identify it in contrast to love? And the way to identify attachment is the underlying hunger. Yeah, there's a hunger or a neediness or a cling that starts to happen psychologically when it's attachment that's driving instead of love. So attachment and love can't drive at the same time, but they can alternate very quickly. Yeah, of I want you to be happy, that's love. Attachment is I want you to be happy in order for you to make me happy, or I want my want for your happiness to be successful and praised, or you know, it's got all these extra agendas with it. So the hunger underneath attachment is what you're trying to find. Because then you can find it in anything when it starts to operate. You can see your attachment to food or situations or other people in other contexts. So if you can feel that like craving, grasping, clinging, hungry, needy feeling, it could be like a hole in your heart or a pit in your stomach or an excited feeling that seems like happiness, but is like sugar rush happiness as opposed to the happiness of a satisfying, healthy meal. You know, when you spike and then crash. So excitement is related to attachment. Contentment, peace, joy is related to love. It's much more steady. So all negative states of mind have an edge of agitation, and that's how you can catch them. When it's just love, there is this real calm together with your joy. So if you think of that same person when it's love and not attachment, say they're having a terrible day and they're crying and they're upset, or they're angry and they're raging. If you're having a love response, you want them to be happy, but you're not trying to fix them. There's like a deep piece of, I'm here. And if there's an opening for me to help, I'll help. If there's not, I'm just here. I'm here. You know, I love you. I'm here. It's really this compassionate presence that we can bring without an agenda that needs to be the grand savior, that needs to fix them or change them. It's just heart open, relaxed, I've got you. Yeah, when it's attachment, we get a little bit of a, oh, I need to make you better, I need to make you better. But it's actually very self-referent, because if I don't make you better, I'm bad and I've made it all about me. Yeah, so just kind of in a quiet moment when you're not too attached, look at when attachment creeps in and what it's like, what does it say? You know, in your internal narrative, then it's easier to catch the next time it comes up. Yeah, and so what we're trying to do is to not get rid of relationships that have attachment. We're trying to have relationships have less and less and less attachment so that there's space for more and more love. So the only reason why monks and nuns don't have romantic relationships is that it's just really natural and normal and easy to get sucked into the attachment kind of wheel in those dynamics, but it can happen anywhere in any dynamic, you know, like the cat and me, right? It's not like you're now separating yourself from attachment. You're just kind of giving yourself breathing room from those relationships where attachment comes the most intensely. But that's not to say that everyone needs to live a life of a monk or a nun to get rid of their attachment, not at all. It's about a deep self-knowledge that knows how easily you're distracted. So it's not like you need to be a very strong person to be a monk or a nun. It's a recognition of how very distracted I am that I live this way. I get way too distracted. I loved relationships. They were so much fun. They were like the funnest thing. They were, you know, so distracting. So I thought, all right, probably best this life. I just give it some space, give it some breathing room, because I will not focus on my path as much if I keep having those kind of relationships. I'll just get lost in them because they're so much fun. And then I'll get to the end of my life and wonder, where did my spiritual path go? And I'll be disappointed. But that's not the case for everyone. Lots of people can use their relationship as their path. There is power in all types of promises. You know, those of you that are married, it's a powerful thing to make a promise to another person, because your lack of equanimity is challenged all the time. You're like, this is not who I thought you'd be, you know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago. This is a whole different person that I did not really know was coming. And yet there's a promise there. And let's see if I can keep my heart open in response to this new person that you've grown into being. You know, it's powerful. It's really ego challenging. So any kind of life is transformative. You just need enough self-knowledge to know what conditions are the most problematic given your own habits, and then choose accordingly. Yeah. So we'll just do a little sit, just let it all kind of settle. And yeah. So next time I'll start with a bit of a loving kindness meditation, but we don't have time today, but I'll start with it next time. So just come back to your posture, come back to your breath. Settle your attention on the breath.
And think, may I send loving kindness, compassion, and equanimity in all directions to all people. And I start by awakening it within myself. And so if it feels comfortable, you can add Om Mani Padme Hum, letting yourself be filled by the wisdom compassion mantra, imagining that it then radiates out. Om Mani Padme Hum, 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 Om Mani Padme Hum. And relaxing your attention. Okay. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Yönten. See you next week. Thank you very, very much.